Hey, honey. I wanted to leave you a little voice note. I'm leaving tomorrow to go up Everest, and I just wanted to leave you this in case maybe something, you know, not so good happens to me up there, and I have a tough time getting down. I guess if you're listening to this, it's because I'm dead. I really just wanted to tell you that I love you so much. I love you so much.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Harold and Rachel, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Thanks so much for having us.
It's so good to have you.
So
I
excited.
Love your smiles, and you just are the epitome of a young couple.
Well, I tell you, I must admit, I have grown up watching Focus on the Family, so it is
so
great.
Well, we love that story, absolutely. Now, we're going to get to your Everest story, but Rachel, let's face facts, right? Having a baby is so far bigger than climbing Mount Everest.
It is. It is. Like, woo! This is my third Everest.
Yeah.
And it has not gotten any easier, I'm not going to lie.
Well, that's wonderful, and congratulations.
Thank you.
That you have your third on the way, and your other two children, how old?
3 and 1.5.
That's awesome.
Yes.
Hard years, maybe in terms of busyness, but great years to look back
on. Best years of our lives.
Yeah, it's all fun. And man, Jean and I have 18 and 20-year-olds, and we're thinking back to when our kids were that young, thinking, will they get out of school? Will they ever graduate? But it's awesome to see. So thanks for being with us. And thank you so much for your service to the country. I mean that. My brother's a vet out of the Navy. I know you're a West Point grad, but man, thank you for what you've done for our country, sincerely.
Well, I appreciate your support. I think it's one of those things, service has always meant so much to me. I think it's so important for this country that I believe in.
And we are going to, you know, that message you left, man, that was a tearjerker as I heard it, you know, and I'm so glad that you kept that and that we were able to play it. But let's start way back. Let's start.
Okay.
Let's talk about how you guys met. This was amazing. The 6-hour phone call. Was that after you saw each other, or how did the 6-hour phone call come about?
Well, the 6-hour phone call happened after a Facebook message first, actually. So my cousin is actually Harold's very best friend. And
so there was that connection.
Yes, that's kind of the original connection. And I guess just told Harold about me. I still don't know why.
So here's how it went down.
Yeah, okay.
All right, so my best friend Tommy was like, hey, I got this cousin. She's a redhead. She's amazing. And I was like, man, I'm just not into redheads.
He didn't know what he was missing out on.
Okay, now it's all
the funny thing is now I have a redheaded wife, I have redheaded kids, and I have a redheaded dog. So God has had a lot of
burn, I would say, isn't it?
Yeah.
But that's, for all the redheads, way to go out there.
Yeah.
Right?
So you pushed through that hurdle.
But let's go a little deeper.
Yeah. So he eventually showed me a picture of her, and I was blown away. And so if you fast forward a little bit, he's like, hey man, I'll pave the way. I'll make sure she knows about you and you can message her. And so I sent her a message actually on Facebook, of all things.
What did you say exactly?
I thought I said something clever. Apparently it wasn't very clever. And she had no idea who I was.
He told me he was in a relationship with my cousin Tommy. So he really threw me for a loop there.
Right, exactly.
But I was like, okay, what's going on? And we started talking back and forth. But then quickly, actually, Tommy decided to hop on Harold's Facebook. Awkward conversation. Things got weird. I got a little uncomfortable.
He was talking as me, mind you.
He was hijacking me. I know my cousin. Let me take over.
Exactly.
Yes. Okay,
and that's very embarrassing thing. So I was like, Rachel, I am so sorry. Can I please get your number? And that's actually how I got a number.
Okay, obviously it worked. 6 hours later, you guys are going, okay, wow. So you had that connection right from the start.
Right away. It really was. It was that first phone call that afterwards we're like, holy cow, I found my person.
Never forget, I was laying in my barracks room. I had a top bunk, and it was, I mean, probably 4 a.m. by that time. It was very late. And I just remember looking up at the ceiling, and we were finishing our phone call. And we literally said to each other, we haven't met in person. And I was like, I found you. Like,
wow.
I found you. I literally told a girl that I haven't even met in person, but it was so clear. It was like, this is her. I just found my person.
Hmm. Yeah, that it's beautiful. I feel Gene and I kind of had that experience too. We didn't go out for a long time. We had friends that were trying to get us together. We finally both said yes. We go to an Amy Grant concert at the Pacific Amphitheater. And then she struggled. She wrote like 7 notes and tore each one up because she was trying to say, hey, I'm really interested. I was already there, like, wow. But it was very similar. It's just like we knew that this was it. And that's such a good feeling. Let me say, and there, the serious side of all that, it's fun banter. It's wonderful to hear how you connected the spark, as we say. But right after you started dating Rachel Harold, your family had a really tough situation that threw you for a loop. What happened?
Yeah, it was about a month after we started dating. My parents actually got a divorce, and to give
Christian
you some,
parents
they are. So I came from an amazing family. They were unbelievable parents. I have just a sister who is so wonderful.
Yeah.
You know, I thought we were the iconic Christian family, you know, just everything that I was so proud of. I thought their marriage was amazing. You know, and so I got a phone call out of the blue from my mom, who was in tears, and you know, hearing that, you know, still so young in our relationship, but hearing of their divorce, I'll never forget. I literally just broke down. The first person I called was Rachel, and I just broke down into tears.
Yeah.
But I tell you, there was a silver lining to all of that. It was incredibly hard for me. It was hard for my sister. But we built our relationship from the very beginning with that in mind, that you have to work at marriage every single day. And so by no means do we have everything figured out. We actually just celebrated our 5-year wedding anniversary. But we know that it is about working on love every single day. You have to choose love every single day, no matter what stage of marriage you're in.
Well, let me ask, you know, because somebody, an older couple with kids in their 20s, may be contemplating that right now, that they're, you know, they've raised the kids. The largest, fastest growing divorce sector, if we could call it that, is what they call the graying of divorce. That when you become an empty nester, you look at each other and go, I don't know you, I don't like you, and I'm done. And it's usually women that are filing for divorce because I think part of their purpose is over and they're not sure who they are now. But that phone call, I want to come back to that. Speak to the parents of adult children that are contemplating that and what that communicated to you. If I can ask you to go even deeper and more raw and maybe the obstacle that created, I mean, your world had to crash because of that.
Yeah, I got some really great advice. And I want to be careful not to speak outside, you know, the scope of what we know. But we got some really great advice from someone's marriage that we really look up to. They're a very strong Christian couple even today. And they said that essentially you are choosing to love your partner every single day. And that you, what it really means when you have kids, is to even put your marriage before your kids. And I think that we saw and we were so blessed that, you know, our parents poured everything they had into us, but at the end of the day, they weren't pouring into themselves and their marriage. And so that's been a very important lesson for us as we have 2 kids with another one on the way, is to make that time, is to find time to even have little moments in the house after they go to sleep, or if you can afford it, find a way to get a babysitter or a relative to come over and be intentional with our love and to always grow the love side, not just, hey, I love you because we have kids together, but I'm actually in love with you.
Yeah, I mean, that is to learn that and to know that 5 years into your marriage, you are so far ahead of 99% of marriages. I mean, I may have learned that maybe 2 years ago. I've been married 34 years, sorry, Gene. But I mean, that's awesome that you were able to come to that conclusion and make something so positive out of that rubble.
And I think that's how God works too, right? I
mean,
he took something that was, you know, one of the darkest points in our family's life, honestly, right? And turned it into something beautiful, right? And I know that it's shaped, my sister just got married a few weeks ago, right? And it's shaping her marriage. So there's beauty that has came out of something that at the time we could never have seen how God was working.
And I'm sure your parents are doing okay.
They are.
And, and at the same time, I appreciate that need to respect them and love them. And I get that. And things happen. And we understand that. But I'm so glad those lessons are not going to waste in your own lives. Harold, you and Rachel, you got engaged, obviously. And then shortly after, you dropped some surprising news on Rachel about a dream you had. I'm laughing because I just love the way this works. You know, hey, you want to get married? Yes. Okay, by the way, I want to fill in the blank.
I made sure I asked the marriage part first before dropping the bombshell.
You're covering your checklist really well. So
exactly. Yeah, so I was, at the time, I was a cadet at West Point. And I never forget, I was sitting in my barracks room, And I wrote out my bucket list. I've always been a huge dreamer.
By the way, that's why you're at West Point.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. And so at the very top of the list was to climb Mount Everest. And I started to realize, you know, I think the only time I really would have to do it would be right after graduating and getting married. And so I actually called Rachel out of the blue and said, I think I want to climb Mount Everest.
Okay, this is so good. And you said...
I just wasn't surprised. Like, yeah. Everyone thinks that I would be like, what are you talking about? But that's just who Harold is. You have to, like, have a deep understanding. Like, he is that big goal type of guy, and he's going to make it happen. And so this is just the next thing.
Mm. Our guests today on Focus on the Family are Captain Harold and Rachel Earls, and they've written a terrific book together called A Higher Calling. And we've got copies of it here at Focus on the Family. Just give us a call, 800, the letter A in the word family, or we're at focusedonthefamily.com/broadcast.
You know, I'm smiling from ear to ear because you guys, you are way beyond your years with wisdom. I mean, this is just, this is Harold. If you know Harold, you know this is what he wants to do.
Yeah.
That's true.
You sound like a very mature married woman who understands her husband so well. And this is right.
I know him better than he knows himself.
That's probably
like,
true.
It is true.
I love that. In fact, Rachel, in your book, Harold says that while preparing for Everest, he was giving you the short end of the stick, even after you got married. Many spouses would not react well to that and would have complained. But you, again, knowing him, continue to support him. So women are screaming back at us right now. Why?
Why
did you do that?
Well, I think it's that ultimate goal of, as my husband, right? I chose to marry him. I chose this life together.
What does that mean?
Well,
because you're saying it. I chose to marry him. And him is just not a blank slate.
Right. Well, because I knew who he was, right? So it was that option of I support him or I don't support him. And if I don't support him, this is going to separate us. Mm. You know, we talk about divorce and how does that happen? Okay, well, separation starts to happen there. You're not united any longer. And so that was really important for me.
Well, I learned, honestly, you know, we made a lot of mistakes early, but something that I learned about love through her and how she just responded to me is that it not only became my dream, it became her dream
as
well.
Wow.
She said, if we're going to run this race, we're going to run it together, and I'm going to run it beside you, and I'm going to be your number one supporter, your number one teammate. And that has taught me so much in marriage and how I want to reciprocate that back to her, right? She has dreams, you know, with YouTube, it's like, what can I do to be on your team? And if that's your dream, it's going to be my dream as well. And that's something that I just really admire about her, you know, from the very beginning.
Mm. Yeah. And Rachel, did you have to push through? I mean, climbing Mount Everest is a pretty risky endeavor. So it's not like, you know, I mentioned my wife wants to write a book. Yeah, I can cheer her on right. that. It's not like she's going to risk her life writing a book. So did you have to push through some fear?
Absolutely. And so many different fears. At the time, we were trying to figure out if we wanted to start our family, get pregnant. What did that look like? You know, I could have a miscarriage. Then I'd be going through that alone. Maybe I would get pregnant. Maybe my husband would die. Then I'd be a single parent. All of those things. Like, this is not a normal thing for someone to think about 23, 24 years old, right after you get married. So it was very challenging, and to not just be consumed by those fears all the time, I had to rely on God. Hmm. Like, I had to just give it all up to him and trust that there was something so much bigger than I could see.
Rachel, I want to dig into that a little bit, because I was, you know, kind of kidding, but not really. A lot of women do go catastrophic on things. Hmm. You know, we're coming through, hopefully, the pandemic and all those things. And Gene and I have friends that have really struggled. Many of them don't know the Lord. Mm. And we recognize that, how much fear has gripped them. And it typically will be the moms we know, that there's just so much fear about job, fear about their kids' surroundings. Yeah. And I, you know, I'm hearing you say, you know, we trusted the Lord, and that is right. Mm-hmm. But go a little deeper with that, with your fears. I mean, what did it mean practically to trust the Lord? I mean, there's a superficialness to some people. How do you go a little deeper to say, God, he's yours, and I trust you?
Yeah, so I think what people might think when I say I trusted God is that I trusted God that he would just protect Harold, and that wasn't what my prayer actually was, because I was very aware that he could die. Like, that was a reality, you know? And so I was trusting God with bigger than that. That, Lord, if my husband does die, then you're going to have to literally scoop me up and carry me, because I will not be able to do this on my own. Mm-hmm. And so it was so much bigger than just like, let me trust that everything is going to be okay.
Yeah.
You know, it was just fully knowing I don't have it all, you know, like I can't be the only one in this situation. It had to be me and God.
Yeah. Harold, let's get to the makeup of your group that went to Everest. That's typically the key component, right?
Right.
Who's with you? Mm-hmm. And being in the military, I know you deeply appreciate that. My sister-in-law actually attempted a climb of Everest and only got up to the fourth camp because of altitude sickness and other things. And you know that better than anybody, what that means.
Sure.
But describe who was with you. It's kind of a historic group, right?
It was. So we actually were the first Army team. We were putting together the first Army team to go and climb Everest. So we had a combat wounded amputee that went with us. He was an absolute rock star. We had a female. She was just an amazing climber. We had a doctor with us as well, and then we had a team of Sherpas helping us pave the way.
And what was it like getting up there? And describe that for the listener. I mean, going from the stage of the base camps and then where
you're headed. I'll tell you. So the first time I saw Everest, we worked our way out. It takes about 2 weeks just to get to the mountain. You're traveling through Tibet. And I'll never forget when I saw Everest for the first time. Our team got out of it. We had this like van that we rented, and we're all giving high fives and we're all excited. But honestly, me, it's like, I was terrified. I mean, it was very dark. It was black. It was incredibly intimidating. And I think it became very real, very fast that a good old Georgia boy who doesn't have a whole lot of climbing experience was about to do something very dangerous.
You start asking, why am I here?
Right.
I mean, that's true. I mean, it's a daunting task, and it's incredible. Rachel, when Harold summited, he accidentally gave you kind of a scare. What happened?
Oh, my goodness. Whew. One of the scariest moments of my life. So I was actually in Guatemala at the time. I had just flown over. I was trying to calculate the time difference when I thought he would summit and get back. And, of course, I had no service because I'm out in this rural town. And so I ended up using my friend's phone. And this text message comes through that says, have Rachel Earls call this number ASAP.
Ooh.
And my heart just sank. Like, why would that message be coming through there? You know, like something terrible had happened. And there was a missed call that came through. Like, nothing was quite working. So I was trying to grab my wallet, go to the internet cafe, and just like waiting in that moment.
Well, mind you, too, this was just a few days prior. I had actually gotten really sick. So I called Rachel right before I was going to make the final summit push. It's about 30 hours straight of climbing, a very intense part.
30 hours straight?
Correct.
From the top base camp?
From advanced camp. You go sleep at a couple camps, but then you make the final push.
Yeah.
And I was sick. I was throwing up. And I told her, I don't think I can go to the summit. I remember I had tears in my eyes. It was a very intense conversation that we had. And the very next day, I was feeling better. And I called Rachel and told her I was going to go to the summit. And that terrified her because she knew. I told her I was feeling better. But quite honestly, I probably was about 80%, but I told her that I was going, and she, you know, so I think her knowing that and then getting that text message really just added, you know, to all of that.
Yeah, it was really that moment of I'm about to find out if my husband is alive or dead. And thankfully, you know, a message came through. It's your Lommel, love of my life. That's something that we call each other. And I just, you know, summited and I'm back. And so just in that moment of relief, I remember I collapsed into my friend's arms and just like, I mean, tears everywhere. I felt like I could breathe for the very first time.
Something I want to touch on is something called summit fever, actually. So, and I definitely had a case of it. It's not what you think, like that kind of sickness. It's actually, you know, signifies that you want to make it to the summit so bad that you're willing to sacrifice everything in order to do that.
Right, you blow by the signs.
Exactly, right? And I blew by every sign. Every sign, I was still probably, you know, only 80%. I lost my goggles on the way up.
Oh,
I mean, just a terrible incident, which is obviously you should turn around and come back, right? But for me, I was so fixated on reaching the summit that I was willing to sacrifice everything, including my you know, lovely wife back home, just to reach the top. And I think there's so many truisms to life in that. that sometimes you get so fixated on your own dreams mm-hmm. or something that you want mm-hmm. to do that you're willing to sacrifice everything, mm-hmm. whether it's your marriage, whether it's your kids. Mm-hmm. And I think there's just so much applicability that I've taken with me. You know,
summit fever. Yeah. Summit fever. You can apply it to just about everything. Yeah. Now, you put the pieces together. You were thankful when he got back down. But getting down, you had some harrowing experiences, right? A near-death experience, actually, that made national news. What happened?
We did. We got hit with a really nasty storm on the way down. Our team actually was not together. We were split up, hit with about 75-mile-an-hour winds. This was above Camp 3. We were coming down, and my Sherpa, we were getting hit with a ton of ice, and he started holding his eyes, and I was like, what is he doing? He kept rubbing his eyes, kept going. Then I noticed he was trying to put on his glove backwards, and it was just weird. He's probably about 20 meters in front of me. And so I worked my way to him, and it turned out he was snowblind, which is when basically your eyelids, freeze shut, or the sun, the reflection of the sun can make you go temporarily blind. There's two different versions. And so he was so cold that he was having a difficult time seeing because of the ice blowing in his face. And so I'll never forget, we were just huddled together. There was a cliff face on our right, and then to the left, we were standing on probably a width no wider than a surfboard, but it was about 7,500 feet straight down. And I was 23 years old, hugging my Sherpa with his face in my chest, trying to warm his eyes.
Huh.
Alone on Mount Everest. I mean, talk about terrified, honestly. You think this machoism that you would be... No, it was terrifying. It was terrifying standing alone. It became very real. Death became very real. You climb past dead bodies. It is very real that death, was near.
Yeah, and that experience is amazing. I just can't fathom not being there, what that must have been like, being on something the size of a surfboard and you have a 7,500 foot cliff and 70-mile-an-hour winds blowing.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, that's perilous. Harold, after you returned home, I think you had a summit party or something like that. I've never had a summit party, so I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about.
It was actually on his birthday, too.
It was on his birthday, no less. But at a summit party, something happened. It wasn't positive. What happened, and how did you guys process this as a couple?
We actually struggled most, to give you guys context, after Everest, mm-hmm. not during Everest. I would say that Everest actually brought us together because it was a mission. We had to do it. We had
a goal.
Yeah, totally focused. But on the back end is actually when you really struggled. And so to tell you that story, we had the summit party. We had all of our sponsors. We had media there, family, friends, anyone who was involved. And so I get up on stage and I just start going down and I thank everyone, and I have Rachel sitting front and center and she's just so proud of me and she looks up at me and I thanked everyone, but I didn't mention my wife, who had been my number one teammate, right? We talk about, she ran that race with me when no one else believed in me, she believed in me. And yet I didn't even, thank her. And did she expect me to thank her? No, but I think that was such a lesson for me. That I think that I took my wife for granted, right? And all that she had done for us.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember right after that, Sergeant Major Burnett got up to speak and the first person he thanked was his wife. And I just started crying.
Did you?
Because, it was his wife. So, of course, thanking her for the support. He wasn't even on the climb, but I was more involved than just being his wife. I did the social media. I got all his outfits ready. I just did all this stuff. So to just even feel like I wasn't part of the team was kind of a letdown.
Well, I think it's important to say, like, I see you, right? And that can be from saying thanks. That can be just the way that you look at each other. But that goes so much more than just a thank you at a summit party of saying, like, hey, yes, we had success in this, but I see you. I see the impact that you've had on our marriage and on my dreams as well.
But Rachel, you're able to get through that and get over that, it seems. Are you tempted when something's a little sticky, you say, Harold?
Oh,
do you remember when you didn't thank me for Everest?
He has learned. Oh my gosh, he's grown tremendously. I mean, we were talking about it yesterday, just about how we have come so far in that area where Everest really set the precedent of our whole marriage, of how we really work together as a team and how we lift each other up all the time, like really recognize recognizing each other, but I'm not somebody to just let something fly by. So it was that night, we stayed up till like 4 a.m, but I just let it all out. You know, I told him how I was hurt, and we were able to talk through it and grow.
Well, I've always loved that about you. Like, she will say if something's not right, which is so important in a marriage. I think the more that you start silencing yourself and you just keep those feelings internally, that's when bigger issues really start to arise.
That's,
you know,
so true.
It's sometimes important. You got to do it in the right way, but you need to tell them, like, hey, this is how I'm feeling. I'm hurt in this way.
Yeah.
And then we always make a promise. We don't want to go to bed mad at each other. So we may stay up till 4 a.m., but it's like, if that's what it takes, we need to have those conversations when those conversations are hard.
Yeah. And in fact, you mentioned when you transitioned back, you had more appreciation for the little things, expressing your love for each other. Just describe that, because I think, again, people that have been married 30, 40 years can benefit from the lessons that you've learned.
Yeah, well, I think when you face something like life or death, it obviously changes you. You know, you just see everything in a new light. I mean, when you played that voice recording at the beginning of this, you almost brought me to tears again, because I think about it now. We have 3 children. I get to watch my husband laugh with our boys, you know, play with them. Like, there's a very real possibility I never would have gotten to experience that, you know. So I just see it through new eyes now, and I want to live in those little moments and know that they are so precious and such a gift.
Well, you said something beautiful in the book, and you said the little moments can turn out to be the big moments, and we found that to be so true in our life.
Well, I think I might translate that into those things that are risky in life that people will shrink back from. Often that's where you're going to find the most profound moments in God.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? So your trust that this was a dream he had, you wanted to honor that. That's an awesome story. And I think, again, we're filled with so much fear at times that we don't want to trust each other's dreams and desires.
Yeah.
And for the listener, if you're ready to start working on your marriage and figuring out what you can do better in your relationship, I'm telling you, you can learn some things from this young couple, and they've captured it in the book. And I'm so grateful that you're here to share that story. Thank you so much. And Rachel, let me say, I thanked Harold for his service, but you're equally a part of that as a spouse, staying back during deployments and things like that. Thank you for suffering through that loneliness for our nation.
I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
We'll get a copy of A Higher Calling when you get in touch. And I might also mention our marriage assessment. Jim, over 1 million people have taken that.
It's free.
5-6 minutes long for you to fill out the assessment. It gives you some great ideas about what's going well in your relationship and what might need more attention. So find the link for that marriage assessment and more details about A Higher Calling at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800-A-FAMILY.
Harold and Rachel, thanks again for being with us. Can't wait to have you back here.
Yeah, we appreciate it. It was an honor. Yeah.
Thank you.
And as a listener-supported ministry, your donations mean a great deal to us. It helps us make programs like this, provide resources to all who call, and to help families worldwide. And if you can, please make a generous contribution, either a monthly pledge or a one-time gift today. And we'll say thanks for joining the support team by sending a copy of this terrific book, A Higher Calling. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.